Started recording.
Whoever is taking the photo, you should warn us before taking the photo.
Sorry, I took a photo of myself. That's all.
Had you pinned your screen before doing that?
I forgot to mute myself. That's all. No, yeah, it's.
By the way, the titles and abstracts are not there anywhere, right? Or are they there now?
It is there. Titles.
They are on the website, Google web page.
Which oh, they are on the web page. Okay.
Yeah, and there's a PDF link.
I'll go there in a moment. I'll just check. Here it is.
It's on the website, yeah.
Under speakers. Okay, fine.
Sure. First thing is the hyperlink.
Yeah, sure.
Who's running Chandrashil? Which of us is recording the videos?
So Vamsi has already started recording. I will also record on my side once we start. So Professor Thangavelu, we can get started if you are ready.
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah. Let me start the recording from my side as well.
Okay, I hope everyone can hear me.
Yeah, Thangavelu, up to you, over to you, let's start.
So for those people who have problem with the video, I'm going to describe what I see on the other side of the screen. I see a lot of old students, former undergraduate students, graduate students, even a grad student, and some family members, batchmates, classmates, maybe some friends and collaborators. So I mean, if this description reminds you of a battle, not a match, that is because I don't have any interest in 2020 match or cricket. And also my vision is not 2020. So this may be a blurred vision, but still welcome to this 2020 match. And fortunately, the driving forces behind this event, Chandrashil, Apurva, Vamsi, and Tejas, they are not at all keen on giving a philosophical discourse. So you will not be bored to death. So we can directly go to the event. So we will start. Welcome to this event. Yeah.
You're also the chair, so yeah. Thangavelu, you're also the chair, so you have to chair the talks. You can't.
Yes.
Yeah.
You can go
introduce the speaker.
The next speaker.
Yeah. Oh, the next speaker. Yeah. Yeah, the next speaker is one of our former students and a present colleague. And where is the title?
Okay.
The title is here. Yeah, I was talking about attachments and detachments, but then fortunately there is an attachment here on the stability of holomorphic disk attached to an n-sphere in CN. So we cannot escape. So at least in mathematics, anything except Bhakti Yoga is all right. Okay, Purvik Gupta.
All right, thank you, Thangavelu. And actually, I'd like to start by thanking all the organizers for putting this event together and for keeping us guessing with the name. I first thought they were going to be 20 minute talks, and then I thought this was inspired by the Tokyo Olympics. And then, you know, fine, I think we'll figure it out by tomorrow. So as the title of the talk suggests, I'm going to talk about a stability result, and the setup of the problem is extremely straightforward and concrete. So I will actually begin with that. But then I'd like to place this result into context because it should be viewed as a first step towards a bigger problem, which is very much open. So all of this is joint work with Chloe Wozniak, who is currently at the University of Kentucky. She was a graduate student when we were working on this project. Okay, so what is the setup? So I'm going to look at the central object is a particular real n-dimensional sphere in CN. So let's say Z1 to Zn are the coordinates in Cn. I look at the plane, which is spanned by Z1 and the real paths of Z2 to Zn. So this is a real n plus one dimensional plane. You will notice straight away that it is foliated by complex lines in the Z1 direction, and that is of relevance to us. And the specific n sphere that I'm interested in is the unit sphere in this plane. So being an n-dimensional ball in Cn plus one, it of course bounds many n plus, so being a sphere in Cn, it of course bounds many topological balls. But from a complex analytic and geometric point of view, one of the things that is of significance is the ball that it bounds within this plane. So that I will refer to as bold Bn plus one. So of course, this ball inherits this foliated structure. It is a disjoint union of an n minus one parameter family of holomorphic disks, whose boundaries are all in this Sn that we started with. From a classical complex analysis point of view, this ball also has the significance that it coincides both with the Hall of holomorphy and the polynomially convex Hall of Sn. Now, computing these hulls is one of the key motivation for studying this problem. However, I'm not actually going to formally define these hulls. I will just tell you their significance. So when it comes to the hull of holomorphy, that has to do with the phenomenon of simultaneous analytic continuation. So to be a little bit more specific, if I take a compact set in Cn, I can consider a certain function algebras on it. So I can consider the holomorphic algebra, which consists of all those continuous functions on K, which are uniformly approximable on K by restrictions of holomorphic functions. So these holomorphic functions just need to be defined on some neighborhood of Sn. And so what does the Hall of holomorphy of K represent? So what will happen is that every element in the holomorphic algebra of K will extend uniquely to an element of the holomorphic algebra of its hull. And that is the maximal set for which this happens. In a similar way, we can define the polynomially convex hull, but one considers a different algebra in this case. One considers the polynomial algebra. In this case, one is looking at continuous functions that are uniformly approximable on K by restrictions of holomorphic polynomials. So there are these two very classical problems of simultaneous analytic continuation and then polynomial approximation of continuous functions. And that is what these hulls sort of tell us about. So anyway, so this is a very specific situation. And in general, the structure of hulls is not necessarily stable under perturbations. And it is of interest to understand when that is the case. So the question that we were interested in is what happens if you perturb this N sphere? We are doing this perturbation in Cn. So of course, we may exit this plane capital L. So now does the perturbed sphere also have a foliated filling? Does the foliated filling also represent some sort of hull for the perturbed sphere? So I would like to now sort of place this in context, because at this point of time, you may be wondering, why have I chosen such a specific setup? What is the point of this particular N sphere? So I'll try to motivate that. By the way, I'm not trying to create an unnecessary amount of suspense. The answer to this question is yes, and that is sort of the central result of this talk, but I will come to that a little bit later. So to give this context, it's very common in several complex variables to do a reality check in dimension one. But here there are two dimensions under consideration. One is that of the ambient space and one is of the submanifold. And in this case, give you a little background, we will talk about one-dimensional submanifold. So we are really just looking at simple closed curves in Cn. And the sort of corresponding geometric problem becomes that when does a simple closed curve in Cn bound a complex variety, a one-dimensional complex variety? This is a non-trivial but completely well-understood problem. So many mathematicians have worked on it, and much better. I mean, I'm stating it for smooth curves, but the answer is known under much less regularity. So here's a complete characterization. It's an analytic characterization, and you can basically tell when a closed curve bounds a complex variety by integrating holomorphic one forms along the curve. And if all those integrals vanish, this is known as the moment condition, then indeed your curve bounds a complex one-dimensional complex variety. So again, from the point of view of complex analysis, what is the relevance of this result? So this result also completely computes for us the polynomially convex hull of the curve that we started with. So it says that, okay, if the moment condition holds, then the hull of this curve will be exactly this variety and nothing more than that, a variety union the curve. And if the moment condition does not hold, then the curve is what is known as polynomially convex. And in this context, what this implies is that any continuous function on the curve will always be uniformly approximable by restrictions of holomorphic polynomials. So just to sort of tie this up with, you know, how we started this talk, in all these problems, I'm going to talk about like several problems of this kind. One always starts with a graph model. So it's always useful to start with...
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
So in this result in the 70s, you're saying also that if it exists, it's unique.
Yes. Exactly.
Otherwise, the next won't make sense. Yeah,
absolutely. It is unique. And in fact, the way I have stated it, since you raised this question, there are also certain regularity statements on the boundary. So I've sort of given you a very, very, the uniqueness is there. Absolutely.
Thank you.
So just talking about the graph version of this problem, I mean, just to tie it up with what we were talking about. So I'll typically give examples in C3. So here, let's just take a very silly curve that already bounds a complex variety, which is you take a complex plane in C2, take a circle in that. So here I've taken the unit circle in the first coordinate, and then you take functions, two complex valued functions on it. You look at the graph under some simple conditions on these two functions. The graph will be a simple closed smooth curve. And then this question of trying to fill that with a variety sort of reduces to trying to extend f and g holomorphically into the interior of the disk. And then in that case, the moment condition becomes a familiar condition about banishing of the negative Fourier coefficients. Okay, so I will talk about let me talk about a similar problem in higher dimensions. So this has been studied for higher dimensional submanifolds. And although this does not have a direct bearing on the result I'm going to state eventually, this is a problem in a similar sort of theme. And so here you want to, in general, know when does a closed submanifold of Cn bound a variety, which could be of higher dimension. And a necessary condition is that your manifold should be odd dimensional. This is also an extremely non-trivial but well-understood problem. At least in this form, it has been solved. And this was famously solved by Harvey and Lawson. By the way, they also did the case of simple closed curves, but we've already discussed that. And so they give a complete characterization of when the odd dimensional submanifold bounds. Here the dimension is 2k minus 1. So it should bound, I suppose my dimension should be correct over here. It should be k minus 1 dimensional complex subvariety. And the condition, which I will talk about a little bit later, this condition of being maximally complex, in contrast to the moment condition, this is actually a local condition on the submanifold. And once again, this also has some implications for Hull. So in this case, what we can say is that this variety, if one gets this variety, then it must lie in the holomorphic Hull of the manifold we started with. And this is to, as we said earlier, this is to do with simultaneous analytic continuation. All right. So I would once again like to talk about a graph version over here, because this kind of takes us back to this question of why did I start with that n sphere? So once again in C3, I want to start with a curve that a three-dimensional manifold that already bounds a complex variety. So I do this thing where I take the Z1, Z2 plane, and I take the unit sphere in that. This is a three sphere, and this itself trivially bounds a complex variety. Now I can take a complex valued function in S3, look at its graph, and then when does that graph satisfy this condition of Harvey-Lawson? That is, in this case, exactly the condition that this function must extend holomorphically to some neighborhood of S3. And then finding this filling is equivalent to finding a holomorphic extension to the domain that is bound by S3. So one thing I want to point out over here, that this three sphere is different from the three sphere that we considered on the first slide. That is kind of an important point over here. All right, so let's just do a where am I heading with this? So I have been interested in trying to understand various hulls of closed submanifolds of Cn. And as we just discussed, this problem is fully understood for closed curves. On the other extreme, you have hypersurfaces where this problem becomes, so in all my, everything is connected in my situation. So in the hypersurface case, this problem becomes a problem about domains, which have also been studied quite heavily, and I'm not going to go in that direction. I'm sort of interested in the case of higher co-dimensions. And of course, we have this nice Harvey-Lawson result for odd dimensional manifolds. But the conditions in the Harvey-Lawson result, they're not generic, which is kind of to be expected because a typical odd dimensional manifold is not going to bound a complex variety. So what is this condition that they have of being maximally complex? So very broadly speaking, what this condition says is that at every point of the manifold, the tangent space over there tries to behave as much as it can like a complex subspace. Whereas a generic behavior for a submanifold in CN is that at most points, the tangent space tries to behave as little as possible as a complex subspace. And so the N sphere that we are going to discuss, that is the central object for us, that is a generic N sphere in CN. So we can sort of view it as a model for studying N spheres in CN. Of course, the question is, why do we want to study N spheres in CN, which I will come to in a bit. And then there is also this issue that, of course, this entire discussion doesn't say anything about even dimensional submanifolds in CN. You can ask similar questions, but there then the questions will not be about bounding complex varieties. It will be about bounding manifolds foliated by complex varieties. And so the starting point for this will be surfaces in C2. And just to tie it up with what we were saying earlier, at most points, the tangent space of such a surface will not be a complex subspace. But there can be finitely many exceptions. And finally, since we are hoping to compute hulls and we are looking for this foliated structure of hulls, an important object in this context is what is known as an analytic disk attached to S. So here S is my submanifold. And what is an analytic disk attached to S? This is a continuous mapping from the closure of the unit disk in C in the complex plane into CN, which is first of all holomorphic in the interior of the disk, and it takes the boundary of the disk to the manifold that we are interested in. That is the attachment condition. Okay, how am I doing on time? How much time do I have?
Till 9:30.
Till 9:30, okay. Fine. So So I actually want to spend some time talking about surfaces in C2. So the result that we are going to state is going to be in all dimensions greater than or equal to 2. I should say that for dimension 2, much better results are known, but not much is known in dimensions 3 and higher. But it's still worth spending some time on surfaces in C2 because this also helps us understand some of the proof techniques that we will need. So, as I said, when we are working with surfaces in C2, there are these, there could be these finitely many points. So there can be these finitely many points where you have complex tangencies. So first we will focus away from these complex tangencies. And if we are looking for these attached analytic disks, then the thing is that away from complex tangencies, there is no systematic way of finding these disks. These disks may not even exist. What we do have a systematic method for doing is that if you already have one attached, So what we do have is that somehow if you're guaranteed the presence of one attached analytic disk to your surface, then there is a way to try and find nearby attached disks. So for this, I'll make another assumption. This is not a very big deal, but what we are assuming, so we are assuming the presence of one analytic attached disk. And I'm also assuming that along the boundary of that disk on the manifold, I can choose a continuous field of tangent frames for that manifold. So this is going to be a pair of vectors whose span is the tangent space at that point. And then we can compute an integer, which basically measures the way this frame is twisting. Okay, so there's a very specific way in which you can do this. This can also be said in the language of Grassmannians, but I'm not going to do that. This is just a way to measure the twisting of this frame. This gives us what is known as the index of this surface along this disk. So for a very quick example, if you take your surface to be the standard torus in C2, which comes from taking the product of S1 cross S1 with itself, and you take the map Z mapping to Z to the K, that is an holomorphic analytic disk attached to T2, and the index will turn out to be K plus one. So what is this? So how does this help? So there is a result due to first marriage, but some of this was probably present even earlier in the literature, that if you can count this index, and this index is at least one, then you are guaranteed a certain number of analytic disks close to the one that you started with. And this is all quantified in this result. I should say that, I mean, there are lots of regularity results for attached disks that I'm not going to go into. On the other hand, if your index is non-positive, then you cannot find any nearby disk. So any disk that you find will just be a reparametrization of the one that you started with. And really the idea of the proof, this is really just a non-linear Riemann-Hilbert problem. The idea is to linearize it and then apply some standard machinery, but this is actually a very useful result for us. So I'll be coming back to this. What happens near complex tangency? So that is very much of interest in this discussion, because in the case of surfaces, complex tangencies can be viewed as the source of these attached analytic disks, which are what we are ultimately interested in. So to understand what is happening near typical complex tangency, so I'm not giving you an exhaustive description, but to understand the typical cases, it suffices to look at a model of quadratic surfaces, or rather just these quadratic surfaces. So these are graphs over the Z1 plane. And in this case, the origin, at least the two cases that I've drawn over here, the origin is going to be an isolated complex tangent. So the surface is going to have a complex tangent at the origin, and that is an isolated point with that property. And so depending on this parameter A, if A is strictly less than one, then you sort of get this elliptic paraboloid. And there are very obvious disks attached to the surface, which you get by taking these lines parallel to Z1. On the other hand, if the parameter is greater than one, then you get this hyperbolic paraboloid, I guess. And in this case, this requires a little bit of a proof, but you are not going to get disks like in the first picture, by which I mean that you are not going to get these small disks close to your singularity. It could happen that if a piece of your surface looks like this, a very large disk from somewhere else, starting from somewhere else, could go and touch this singularity. That is a different matter, but you're not going to have these collection of disks near the singularity. And this is kind of relevant from the point of view of what we are discussing. So why is it, why are these two models sort of nice? Because for surfaces, typical complex tangencies can be modeled by either of these two pictures. And then what we are discussing here, this is probably historically like the first result in this direction. So Bishop observed that anytime your surface has an elliptic singularity, so it's modeled by the first picture, then that surface near that singularity will have disks that look like what we have in the picture over there. So you will have a one parameter family of attached disks that are shrinking down to the singularity. And anytime you have, so in general, why do we look for attached disks? Because as soon as you have an attached disk, it is going to lie in the polynomially convex hull. It may not immediately lie in the hull of holomorphy, but anytime you have this structure where you have this continuous family of disks, then that gives you a handle over the hull of holomorphy. So in any case, near these elliptic singularities, we have this family of disks. So when Bishop produced these disks, he also asked the following question, that are these all? Once you have these kind of disks, they immediately lie in the hull of holomorphy of the surface. And his question was that, you have these disks, are they unique? If you look at the manifold that they are spanning, first of all, you want to make sure that a piece of your surface lies in the boundary of that manifold. What about the regularity of this filling that you have got? Is it as smooth as the surface that you started with, especially if your surface was C infinity or real analytic? And so basically you're looking for a foliated filling with good regularity properties. So this is known as the local Bishop problem. And in dimension two, this was a particularly hard result to prove, which was proved in many, many cases, but it was eventually settled. So since we are talking about n-dimensional manifolds in CN, I want to talk about what happens in n-dimensional in the n-dimensional case. So complex tangencies become more complicated and they become harder to classify. However, this category of elliptic singularities and these Bishop disks that come with them, they do exist in higher dimensions. So the same result holds in higher dimensions. The only difference is now your singularity entities are not isolated. So in an n-dimensional manifold, there will be n is two-dimensional worth of these singularities. So you get many, many disks attached near a singularity. Even in this case, the local Bishop problem makes sense, and it was eventually settled by Huang. So what we are sort of, the broad question that we are sort of interested in is known as the global Bishop problem. So what this is that you take an n-dimensional manifold in CN. Let us assume that it only has elliptic CR singularities, because then this gives us at least some disks to begin with. We are interested in computing its Hall of Holomorphy. One has to impose certain convexity conditions. So here we have assumed that it sits in the boundary of a pseudo-convex domain. It's okay if you don't know what that means. And the question is the Hall of Holomorphy of this manifold an n plus one dimensional manifold that is foliated by analytic disks attached to S? So this is also referred to as a Levy-flat CR manifold. Is this manifold going to be as smooth as S was all the way up to the boundary? So that is the global Bishop problem. Of course, this manifold has to be the boundary of this hull. That is what we would like. And so let me first say that in dimension two, this condition of only having CR singularities is very rigid. It basically tells you that you can only be a sphere with two elliptic CR singularities, because there is a counting result for singularities. This is not known in higher dimensions. It's sort of conjectured that even in the case of higher dimensions, you will have to be a sphere, which is one of the reasons why we study spheres. In dimension two, this problem is completely well understood. Even beyond the formulation of the Bishop problem, people have also considered hyperbolic singularities. This has also been done for merely continuous functions. The picture I have over here is a picture of one of the first results in this direction, where they had taken a graph form for capital S. I should say that even prior to this, the first result in this direction was a stability result. And so that brings me to the next point, that nothing is known about the global Bishop problem in dimensions three and higher. So despite all the full understanding of two spheres in C2, we do not understand much about n spheres in CN. And so the stability problem that we are studying is sort of the first result in that direction to say that we can even expect these kind of results. And let me just quickly say, that even though I said that the problem of two spheres in C2 has not been generalized for n spheres in CN, two spheres in C2 can also be viewed as co-dimension two submanifolds. So people have studied a different type of generalization where they have looked at co-dimension two submanifolds of CN, and then they have looked for fillings that are hypersurfaces. So you get hypersurfaces that are foliated by complex varieties, and that resembles the Harvey-Lawson. So it's kind of a parametrized Harvey-Lawson problem. So there you need some necessary conditions, and then the conditions on the manifold are no longer generic. Okay, so finally, let me come to the main result. So I'll just recall that this SN was this unit sphere in this plane that was trivially foliated by lines. What are we doing? So we do C3 small perturbations. So in our result, we do C3 small perturbations. The identity plus small phi is going to be my perturbation map. And we show that this perturbed sphere will always bound an n plus one dimensional ball. So it has the topology of the ball. In fact, it is going to be C2 close to the ball that we started with. It is foliated by an n minus one parameter family of disks that are attached to this perturbed sphere. If this perturbed sphere is either C infinity smooth or real analytic, then so is this ball, this filling. And finally, we want to be able to say that this ball coincides with either the Hall of Holomorphy or the polynomial Hall of the perturbed sphere. We were only able to do this in the under the assumption that the perturbed sphere is real analytic. And even in that case, we needed some technical assumptions on the radius of convergence of this perturbation map. So, just before I say a few things about the proof, let me make some comments about, so something that I have not written on this slide, but I have said before, nothing new is being said in dimension n equal to two, much better results are known. So this result should really be viewed in dimensions three and higher. What changes, what makes it so difficult in dimensions three and higher? I mean, it's a difficult problem in dimension two as well, but what makes it different is that first of all, your singularities are non-discrete. So the source of these Bishop disks, it's very large. So you get a lot of disks, and that is a problem because you're trying to establish the regularity of the filling. So you might have these disks that come in hit each other. So you need to worry about that. And then this filling that you produce, it is of high codimension. So in the case of surfaces in C2, you get a hypersurface. And usually when you get a hypersurface, there's very little wiggle room. So establishing that that is the hull is a bit easier. Whereas when the object that you have produced is of high codimension, there's a lot of wiggle room. And saying that you can't have other things coming and contributing to the hull becomes a lot harder, which also explains why we need so many conditions for B. So if I can take maybe a minute or so too, which I think I was told in the chat that I can,
No, you can go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to maybe just run over some of the ingredients in the proof. This is just a single slide. Just to say that, of course, I mean, there are, of course, okay, so let me go ahead and do that. So there's a, so we've already looked at the original sphere that we started with. It has n minus, it has an entire sphere of CR singularities, which are elliptic. And elliptic singularities are remain elliptic under small perturbation. So there's local structure will persist. And then there is a preliminary step one has to prove, this is not hard and not unexpected, that even the global structure of the set of CR singularities persists after a small perturbation. And then near these set of singularities, the local Bishop problem is already giving us a nice filling. So that is kind of a black box for us. We don't have to worry about that part, although it will play a role later. What do we do away from these singularities? So earlier I said that we have some systematic way in that once a given disk exists, that method also exists in higher dimensions, but we do not have these pre-existing disks. So here we very much rely on the special form of SN. And this partial problem was considered by Alexander at some point of time, where he studies the actual functional equations for what it means for a disk to be attached. So you can write these functional equations. So you have to find these disks, which on the boundary satisfy certain nonlinear conditions. And I will not, maybe I was going to say a little bit more about this. So maybe I can do that actually. So if you look at the second line, remember FJ is holomorphic. You're saying something about the imaginary part of FJ. So you can now bring in the Hilbert transform. So if you're looking for a holomorphic function and you're kind of prescribing the imaginary part, then you can take a stab at the real part of the holomorphic function. Here, I have also introduced a parameter TJ, and this parameter will help us produce many, many disks. And then you feed this into the first equation, and then you reduce it to the problem of finding a single attached disk. So this is just like some nonlinear function analysis. You have to do implicit function theorem and appropriately set up Banach spaces. The point is, the problem with this approach is, even though it gives us all these disks, we do not get the desired regularity. So if you only allow, if you take a small C3 small perturbation, you get a C1 smooth filling. If you want a CK smooth filling, then you have to do a CK plus two small perturbation. And then the problem is that now if I want to look at smooth perturbations, I don't get anything at the end. So how do you fix that? What you do is you apply this strategy, you get the C1 smooth filling. Now you have disks already. You apply this machinery that I mentioned of counting the indices, and somehow applying this machinery helps us smoothen this manifold. So you really have to apply both these procedures. And then for the real analytic case, I will not say anything. There's a very standard trick of introducing another variable and complexifying the entire picture. So anyway, I think I will end over here just to say that, this is kind of a first result in this direction of trying to understand fillings of n-dimensional manifolds inside CN. All right, thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for an interesting talk. Are there some questions or comments? Yeah, Apurva has, no.
No, not a comment.
Not a question. Yeah.
Not a question.
Okay, maybe I'll ask a quick question. Purvi, you had mentioned at some point, this was the situation where the boundary of the disk does not contain any CR singularities. That was the very first case. In which case you mentioned that the number of parameters that parameterize the family of disks is given in terms of an index.
Mm-hmm.
Is it correct that when you make when you say away from complex tendencies, so then one is looking at the determinant of some kind of a map. You mentioned a Grassmannian. This is in fact a Grassmannian of totally, totally real subspaces, right?
Right, absolutely.
Now if one were looking at the family of Lagrangian subspaces, then there is an index like a Maslow index. This is that sort of an index, correct?
Exactly.
All of the same properties as the Maslow index,
right?
Correct?
I mean, maybe some people in complex analysis may have referred to this as a Maslow index as well, but it is very much that it should remind you of that. Absolutely.
Yeah. Thanks.
I have a quick question, Purvi.
Go ahead.
So you said that this Forstnerich technique that you used later on, that mm-hmm. also seems to rely on the implicit function theorem in Banach spaces, the perturbation. What's the difference then between?
Between
what you did. I mean, there are two steps, right? Before you use
Okay. Yeah, I can say what the difference is very quickly. So what happens is, in the first case, the first to the perturbed sphere, okay? And so that allows me to construct disks on the perturbed sphere where the perturbation is C3 small. Now, if I assume that the perturbed sphere is CK small, so the perturbation is C3 small, but the map is CK smooth. So the perturbed sphere is CK smooth. Now, sitting on that perturbed sphere with this pre-existing disk, so when I say that the filling is smooth, the individual disks will actually all be CK smooth up to the boundary. This is a standard result in the literature that if you are a disk attached to a CK smooth manifold, then there is a small loss of regularity. So let's say CK minus one. So the individual disks in this filling will be CK minus one, but they will not vary in the correct amount. So they'll only vary C1 smoothly. Now sitting on this perturbed sphere, I can apply the Forstnerich technique within that CK smooth sphere. And there I can apply it in CK smooth spaces because my sphere is CK smooth and my individual disks are CK smooth. So I don't know if I'm-
I see. Okay.
So I mean, the first step is to move from the unperturbed sphere to the perturbed sphere. Then there is a second step where you observe that the individual disks in this filling are as smooth as the perturbed sphere. Then you need to make the family as smooth, and there to that unperturbed sphere you apply this Forstnerich setting within staying within that sphere, and you kind of continuously smoothen it. There is a uniqueness statement, by the way. So the Globevnik machinery will produce new disks, and you will have to say that these are the same disks as we had produced via Alexander.
Oh.
So one has to say that, because otherwise, for every k, you could be producing a different family of disks.
Okay, thanks.
Are there some more questions? Otherwise, let's thank Purvi for a nice talk once again. We can start in 2.